Hi everyone. Through this tutorial, we are planning to give a small help documentation or a quick overview of problem solving for assignment 2. And Raviraj will take us through different steps for solving a particular problem, any deep learning problem. But this is very contextual and specific to assignment 2. And I'm hoping this will help you a long way in solving the problem. Yeah, with that, I'll let Raviraj take over this. Raviraj, please.
Yeah, thanks, Chanakya. Hello, everyone. Hope you're doing good. So today we are going through different steps of problem solving. So out of all the steps, the first problem is fetching data, right? So suppose if you have any data set, any curated data set, or like even if you are creating a data set of your own. So that's the first step in any problem statement, right? So here, we have a link here, so which is a zip file. So we need to take that file into our session, and then we should be able to use that file, right? So here in this file, we have train folder and test folder, and then like we have a CSV to predict the values. So inside each folder here, we have labels. So if you have a structure like this, how to read this data? So we have thousands of images here, and inside each train and test, we have multiple images. So as you know, these images are like, computers can't understand images. Computers understand only numbers. So what we have to do, we have to take each of these image, and we need to convert this image into numbers, because computers can only understand numbers, and those numbers are called pixels for an image. So if you take an image, each image consists of pixels. So those pixels we'll read, and then we'll use those pixels to represent the image in the data. So here what I'm doing, this is a zip file, right? So I need to download this file. So for that, so this is a shared Google Drive link. So this is someone else's drive, and then they have shared this file. So I should be able to download it, right? There are multiple ways. Either I can download this and then like read it, upload it to Colab, or if you are using your local system, you can just read it from your Jupyter. And for now, I have just chosen one third party library called Google Drive Downloader, where you just need to mention the file ID. The file ID which you see here, so you just need to mention the file ID and the path. Destination path will be the path where you will be saving that file, which is content/animals.zip. And when you give unzip equal to true, it will unzip the file. Why do you need to unzip the file? So you zip the file to compress the data, and then so that file will be saved anywhere. But once you take that zip file into your session, you should be unzipping it first. Once you unzip it, then your images will be available for reading. So I'm running this. When you run this, so it will start downloading the data. So even if it is big, since it is using cloud's internet, it will be much faster. So if I refresh, you will be able to see the file here. So this is the file which got downloaded, and then it got unzipped as well, as you can see. So if you don't unzip it, you will just see a zip file here. But if you unzip it, you can see it got extracted. As you can see, you will have multiple files inside test and train. So inside train, you will have five folders with each consisting each label. So you need to read this data, right? So for that, there is another way, and what else you can do. So either you can download the file from a shared link. Also, you can download it to your browser, from your browser, and then upload it to your own Google Drive. Once you upload it to your own Google Drive, then you can mount your drive to Colab. So to explain you a few of the pre-processing steps, I need to use another data set. So that data set I'm actually downloading from Kaggle. So it is a different data set from the data set we are using in the assignment. So this is dogs versus cats. So we need to build a classifier for an image where like the model takes an image and then like tells whether it is a dog or cat. So I have already downloaded the data set here from Kaggle. So you can see these are the steps. You can go through the steps if you want. So here I have downloaded the data set already. And once I have the data set, I'll have the zip file here. So once I have the zip file, I need to unzip it, right? So for unzipping, you need to use unzip command in Colab. So once you do that, it will unzip the data set. So as you can see, it is having dogs and cats, both labels. So it will create a new folder for you, which will have train set and testing set. So here you can see two labels, and testing set also you can see two labels. So we need to read this data, right? So that is your another step. So far we have seen the steps, different types of approaches to download the data. And now we have to load the data, right? So we'll see the first method. So what we can do without using TensorFlow or Keras, you can just directly read these files and then create a NumPy array, right? And then once you have that, then you can directly fit the model. So what I'm doing here, I'm not using any high level API to load the data. I'm just writing everything from scratch. So here I have imported all the required libraries. And then these are the class names, cats and dogs. So these are the labels, right? And the image size which I want is 224 by 224. That's why I've given 224 here. And I have defined a method, get data from folder here. So for this, you need to pass the path. Once you pass the path, it will read all the data inside that path. So for that, what I'm doing, I'm iterating through the class names, which is dogs and cats. And then I'm creating a path here. So which is, this path is dataset/training set. So that is dataset/training set. And then inside that, you will have cats and dogs, right? So that will be your class name. And then once you go inside this, so this will give you all the files. So to read each and every file, I'm iterating through all those files here. And I'm using computer vision imread method to read it as an array. So once you use imread, so it will read the image. And then in the next step, I'm resizing the image, whatever the size it may be. Once you resize it, so here, as you can see, I'm defining the image size as 224. So if you resize it, it will get resized to 224 by 224. And once it is processed, in the next step, I'm just adding the future, which is pixels as an array, and the class names. So this is the target variable. And then once you return that, that will be your data. So here you can see, I'm reading the training data. So you just need to pass the path here, dataset/training set. So this will read training data. And if you give testing set, this will read the testing data. And you can use this further to fit your model. So we can go on to the next method. So here in this method, what is the drawback? So you can read the data, but most of the times you can't augment the data. If you want to augment, then you have to use some other approach, right? Also, it is you are creating the labels by yourself and then like you are appending to the image. Instead of that, what if we have a method to read the labels directly from the directory structure itself? Directory structure as in, so here you can see, right? So you just need to give this data set. The method will understand. So it will take this folder as training set and this folder as test set without you explicitly mentioning anything like in the above. And also, if you go to the training set, so it will create labels cats and dogs, and then like it will attach each and every image with the label. So that also you don't need to do anything explicitly. That model will do everything for you based on the directory structure. So here I'm using image dataset from directory method from Keras pre-processing. So here you just need to use this method, which is from pre-processing module. So image dataset from directory will take the directory path, and labels inferred will be, so you are telling the Keras to take the label names from the directory structure like cats and dogs, and also label mode int will assign integer value to each and every label. Like if cats, it will assign 0, and then like for dogs, it will assign 1. And this validation split, you know, right? So this is for splitting the training data into train and validation. So it will take 80% of the data as training data set and 20% of the data as validation data set. So here seed, you use it for a replication. And image size, we already mentioned here, we want it in 224 by 224. You don't need to explicitly resize it. Like here we have done the resizing, right? So you don't need to do that. You just need to pass the image size here and it will resize it for you. And also you can pass the batch size. So here, if I load this, it will actually load the data from this path. So here you can see it has taken 6,400 files as training and 1,600 files as validation. How easy is that when compared to the method above? So you just need to give the directory path and it will take care of everything. You don't even the splitting, right? You just need to mention the validation split percentile. So that will actually split the data for you. And it also says how many classes are there. We didn't mention the classes, right? Anywhere. We didn't mention anywhere the number of classes, but it still took it as 2. Why? It has read the directory structure and it has seen that there are 2 folders inside training. That's why it is known that there are 2 classes in the data set. And you have to read the test data as well, right? So once you read the test data, so it will create one more data set with the files inside test data set. So that is this folder, test set. So it will read, there are 2000 files in test data set, and then there are 2 classes, obviously. So we have read that, right? Now let's just visualize the data and see whether the data is good or not. Sorry, I need to. So we need to import the matplot library to visualize, right? So is matplotlib dot pyplot. So as you see, it will visualize the data, right? So here we have label 0 is cat and label 1 is dog. So here you can see we got the correct data, right? So it is labeling correctly. Now, what's the next step? So we have loaded the data, but what if we have less data? And then like, what if we want to do the augmentation, you know, data augmentation, right? So basically each image, you just rotate it, flip it, and then like zoom it. So you just create different types of images from a single image. So that is data augmentation. For that data augmentation, again, after loading this data set, I have to mention it, mention to the Keras, right, that we need to do data augmentation. So here what I have done, I have defined a sequential model and then I have passed all the steps to augment. So this is horizontal flip and then like rotation range is 0.1 and zoom is 0.2. So these are the 3 steps which I needed to do for the augmentation. There are other steps as well, but I'm taking only these 3 options to augment the data. So once you define this, then you need to augment it, right? So let's just see how the augmented images looks like. So as you augment, the data will rotate, flip. So here you can see there is I think that's a cat. So as you can see, the rotates are flipped and then like rotated. So a lot of things happen. Let's just take a better one.
Ravi, one quick question here. So basically, when you say augmentation, it means that it can be rotation of the image and things like that, right?
As you can see here, the dog is like rotated and then zoomed. So yeah, it is basically a single image, but so many images will get created. So this gets used when we have less data and then like we want the model to perform better.
Okay, so you are basically creating synthetic data in this case for
Yes,
that? Or?
yes.
Okay,
Yeah,
great.
yeah.
Yeah, got it.
So this is just to visualize, but I haven't augmented my data set yet. So if you want to do that, you basically need to add the dot data augmentation in the flow, right? So one way is to add the data augmentation before you start creating your model. So suppose if I have a layer like this, if I have a fully connected layer with 1024 neurons, before feeding it as an input, what I'll do, I'll just augment the data. And then also you need to standardize the data. You remember, like, we are dividing it by 255. Also, you might not have seen this format before. This is called functional models. So functional models are like, you basically like take the output of one layer and feed it to the next layer. So here what I have done, so this is the input, right? So there is one option to give the input shape in the input method. So keras.input will create input for you. And then this input you need to pass to the next layer, which is data augmentation layer. So the output coming from this data augmentation layer will be passed to the next layer again. So that is this. So here my layer is rescaling layer. So this rescaling layer, what it does, it will divide each pixel with 255, because the pixel range, if you remember, it is 0 to 255. So once you do this, you will have all the pixel values between 0 and 1. So you take output of the previous layer and feed it to the next layer. Also next layer. So these values coming from rescaling will be fed into the next layer, 1024 neurons hidden layer. And next layer is dropout, right? So this gets inputted to the next layer. Like that, you will create outputs as well. And then you will create a model with inputs and outputs. You just need to map it. So it will create a model for you. This is called functional way. Why this is useful is that you don't need to follow a sequence of steps, but you can concatenate multiple inputs and then like pass it to a single layer. So this helps you define complex models. But as sequential, if you see, there is only sequential.
Ravi,
if you see, there is
only, yeah. Just to interrupt. So basically this functional model is something that we are introducing for the first time, right? We haven't taught this, but
yeah,
otherwise, like, you know, they should be able to grasp it easily. And we have been doing sequential way of building models, which we will also discuss, right? So just for the understanding of the audience. Yeah, cool.
So basically you can see I have written the same model in the sequential way as well. So here we have defined a sequential model, and then we have added multiple layers here. First one is data augmentation layer, then rescaling layer, then dense dropout, again output layer. So you can see that this model and this model both are exactly same. It's just that you are feeding each output explicitly to the next layer, whereas in this case in sequential way, so you don't need to mention anything. When you add it, it will just feed the output of that layer to the input of the next layer. So there is another way. So you just need to, there is a function called map. As you can see, it's exactly same as the pandas map we have. So for each series, we just map it, right? So here what you can do, for each data set, you can just give dot map and a lambda function. So this lambda function has two variables, x and y, where x is an image and y is the label. So what you are doing here, so you are mapping each x with the augmented x and then y here. So x augmented x, what happens? It will randomly augments that image and then creates multiple pictures, right? And why training equal to true? We want this to happen only when training is happening. That's why training equal to true. So this will actually create an augmented train TS, and then this data set you can directly use to fit your model. So image data set from directory. So here when you read the data, you had to augment the data separately and rescale the data separately, right? So for augmentation, we have added these layers. For rescaling, we have added another layer here. So this is like an extra overhead. So what we can do, we can directly use image data generators to load the data. So we can skip all the steps above, and then you can just start the model from here, which is after downloading, you can just load the data. So how do you load the data? You just import this image data generator, and then you just mention rescale option here. So once you mention the rescale option, while loading the data from directory, which is this dogs versus cat, while loading the data itself, it will just rescale the values. And also, if you mention all these augmentation attributes, it will augment the data for you. You don't need to alter the model structure to add the augmentation and then alter the train data set. It will directly load the augmented data. I mean, it will load the data and then it will augment it for you. And also, you can just mention the test data generator. For this, we just need rescaling. We don't want any data augmentation. That's why we haven't mentioned any data augmentation steps here. And once you mention these generators, so here, as you can see, we didn't pass any directory path, but we want the data to be read. So for that, you need to use one method called flow from directory. So these generators are like just initializing. You are just initializing data generator, and then this flow from directory is actually reading the data. So here you need to pass the path and then batch size and class mode binary, because I have only two classes. I want it to be binary cross entropy. So again, binary cross entropy, because like I want binary cross entropy loss, that's why I have mentioned it as binary. And also if you mention categorical here, you need to have multiple labels, and then your loss will be categorical cross entropy. And also there is one more class mode called int that will actually directly do label encoding, whereas binary and categorical is one hot encoding. And then this target size you directly mention here, 224 by 224. So this will read the data for you. This train generator object will contain all the data because you are giving the path and all the necessary details here. And also test generator will have all the data here in the test generator. So here, as if you read it, so you will have 8,000 in test data, in train data, and 2,000 in test data. But you might ask, what if I want validation data set? So for validation data set, you need to create another data set. And then like, as you can see, you can just mention the validation split here. So validation split equal to 0.2. And you can just create one more data generator. So this is the test data generate. So here what you can do, you can just mention the validation data generator. So this will be your validation data generator. And here you need to pass the validation split again. Sorry. So once you do that, you are creating a validation data generator as well, but you need to read the data, right? So for that, what you need to do, you need to read the same data as train, because you need to create validation data from train data set, right? So for that, you need to create a validation generator here, and then you need to use val data gen object, which we create here, and then flow from directory will be the same training data set only. And here you just need to mention the subset as validation. And then here subset will be training. Sorry. So as you can see, so it read the data, right? So 6400 is for train, 2000 is for test, and 1600 is for validation. So each has two classes. That's how easy it is to read the data. So here I read train data, test data, and validation, which is in the same order, train, test, and validation. So once you have the data, you can just create a model and then use the model.fit. So you just need to pass the details like this. You need to pass train data generator and test generator. And then like other values, you know, number of epochs and verbos and batch size, whatever you want, you can just pass here. So this will create the model for you. So I'm leaving out the creating model part because that's the important part in assignment. So I just want to explain you different steps, but creating the model and all, you have to do it on your own. And once you have the model fitted and ready, you just need to evaluate the model, right? So you can just use evaluate method, model.evaluate, and then you can just pass train data, train generator, and then this will give you the test accuracy. And also to predict the data, you just need to pass the labels. So for now, you actually need to read that CSV file, which we have given in the assignment. And then like based on that CSV file, you need to read the data from test folder, and then you need to pass those values to predict. So once you do that, so these predictions will actually depending on the output layer and what kind of activation you are using on output layer. So once you use softmax activation and sparse categorical cross entropy or binary cross entropy, so it will just give you multiple probabilities. So out of all those probabilities, you need to get the max probability index, and that will be your predicted class. And for that, you need to use numpy's argmax function, np.argmax. And these predictions will be of shape. Suppose if you have 1,000 samples, and the prediction shape will be 1,000 by 2, because we have two classes, right? So each class will have a probability. Out of these two classes, the max probability index is your class. Suppose if you have 0.99 for index 0 and 0.01 for index 1, my predicted class will be 0, and that is cat. So here this axis equal to 1 is mentioned, and so that like for each sample we need this, right? So that's why we mention axis equal to 1. And how do you get the final predictions? So these predicted labels are just the integers, either 0 or 1 in our case, because we have only two classes. So these predicted labels are numbers. And how do we convert this into strings? So if you remember, I have defined a class names array with cats and dogs. So basically what I have done, I'm iterating through all the predicted labels. And for each predicted label, I'm getting the value. So if I is 0, it will be cat. If I is 1, I'm axing the index 1 from class names, which is dog. So that's how you get the class names to the target variable. So these final predictions will contain all the class names for each predicted sample. Yeah, I think that's it for now. Like we have mentioned all the pre-processing steps and then how to approach this problem. So basically model creation and all, you have to do it on your own. Maybe it can be CNN or it can be transfer learning. So basically we do all these things. So CNN, you need to define it from scratch. And if you use transfer learning, you can use multiple models which are already preloaded. So you can use VGZ or any other preloaded model. And then based on that model, you can just create your model and you can just you can do the predictions on the test data set easily. Yeah.
Great. Yeah. Thanks. Thanks, Ravi. So basically in nutshell, if I'm not wrong, you have explained various ways to load the data set, right? And also, and then like, you know, we went about building a small model and then doing the predictions. Okay. And also on the other end, like, you know, we have introduced a lot of new terms, which the beginners may not be aware of, but these are not so fancy or like, you know, not so difficult to grab, like be it data augmentation and the recent words that Ravi used, let's say VGG 19 model. VGG 19 is nothing but a CNN it was discussed in CNN session, which was delivered by Dipanjan. To be honest, like, you know, in the entire assignment, right, you pretty much have all the notebooks available out there. You just need to understand what you need to achieve for a particular task that was given. And pretty much all the tasks have some relevance with some of the notebooks that we have shared and all the sessions that we have shared so far, right? It has 100% correlation, or like, you know, you just need to navigate through the notebooks. You just need to understand what was taught. And I think you should be able to seamlessly do the assignments with ease. That shouldn't be an issue at all. But apart from that, coming to loading the data set, even today, like, you know, you might have seen different ways of different approaches. But to be honest, like, you know, you can pick one of the approaches and go ahead with solving your assignment. Ravi, can you quickly summarize what all different approaches we have used for loading the data? Let's say, for example, we have used data image.
So first method is like, without using anything, you can just use OpenCV to process your data. So you can just iterate through the directories and then get the file paths and read each path and then create the data by yourself. So here, if you can see, I'm just creating the data by myself. I'm attaching the image here. I'm attaching the label here. I'm creating the entire data by myself, which is pretty tiresome. But sometimes you might need to do this when you don't have a directory structure like this. Suppose my data is not organized at all. Suppose here you have cats and dogs folders, right? So this is an advantage for you because there are so many methods which are available, which can directly infer the labels from this directory structure. But what if you have, so inside each image name, you have the label. So here, like you can see, right, I can have a different folder name here, but I can have cat written on the name of the image. So in that case, what I need to do, I need to read all the files and I'll just check for the name. So if the name contains the string cat, then I'll assign that to cat. If the name contains the string dog, then I'll assign that to dog. So this gets used when you have data with no particular directory structure, but you have to read the data. So in that case, it's better to write your own method to read the data. So other than that, if the directory structure and all is good, like train and test, inside train and test, the labels are divided categorically. So that will be, then these kind of methods will come into picture, image data set from directory. So what this does, this will directly load the data with the directory structure given above. And once you load the data, you need to again rescale the data. And then like you need to do augmentation to have a better model. So also image data generator is the next method. So this will solve all the problems which we have till now. So if you have a directory structure like this, you just need to mention the rescaling range and all the data augmentation attributes. So this will do everything for you. You just need to mention the validation split here. And once you do that, so with this much of code, I was able to load all the data sets, training data set, validation data set, and testing data set, and also the classes, everything, right? So it is widely used because of the same reason.
Yeah. So that pretty much sums up. So basically, like, you know, we have explained three ways of loading the data. And the first thing is, if you're not understanding some keywords, right, just Google. Just the first thing that you can do is, like, you know, try to Google it. You will find some relevant content on Stack Overflow or on first few results of Google. Try to learn from it. I mean, like, you know, if possible, like, you know, try to open it and try to understand what it is all about. So for example, let's say data augmentation, you can search for data augmentation on Google and then you will understand what it is. Probably I'll just share my screen, Ravi. So let me just quickly share my screen. Yeah. So if I have to learn what is data augmentation, probably I'll just search for data augmentation, and then I'll quickly see, like, you know, I can already see some results out here. I can simply go here and learn from it. or I can simply open these images and try to understand what data augmentation is. So as you can see, the image is put up this way, and it is being rotated, and it is being rescaled, or whatever it is being oriented in different angles, and that is nothing but data augmentation. Okay, so by looking at these probably images, or probably by reading these articles, we'll be able to understand what data augmentation is all about. Okay, so it's not something fancy, and I think similar approach goes for each and everything. And if you are still stuck, or if you are having any other questions, you can always reach out to us on help channel, and we should be able to have some answers for you. Okay, with that, I think we are pretty much done with it. Ravi, do you want to add anything, or we are good to go?
Yeah, Chanukya, I'll probably add a few words. So basically, yeah. For all the beginners out there, it might be just overwhelming with everything, but that's completely fine. When I started, I used to struggle continuously, like 5-6 days on each problem. And then like I used to get frustrated, but that's completely fine, because like you're completely new to your domain. And then like when you start with something, initially it will be a little harder, but rely on internet. So it basically everything is out there. Suppose if you want to search image data generator, right? So you just need to search how to use image data generator, and then like just give Keras. So if you mention the correct keywords, it will just lead you to correct link, maybe Stack Overflow or towards data science blogs. So these blogs are very useful. And then like, so all the problems you face, those are already faced by someone else. So like your problem is not new. So whatever problem you are facing right now, someone has already faced it and solved it before. So with that, you can just search everything online, and then like once you get it, you just need to know like how to search properly. That's it.
Yeah, true. Totally aligned. And reduce as much dependencies as possible, because so that you can do it yourself. But that being said, like, you know, we are always there. Okay. And thanks a lot, Ravi. Thanks for your valuable time. And thanks, everyone. Bye.
Yeah, thanks, Shankar. Thanks, everyone.